Great. Hello, everyone. Now I sound like a New York MTA announcer, but given the plurality of temporal zones, this is appropriate. Welcome to another installment of Ukrainian Energy Series, a sequence of lectures and presentations that is run out of the Jordan Center with the participation of Professor Gillian Porter, Professor Maya Vinakur, and myself, Anastasia Osipova, but is an event that is organized with the participation also of University of Colorado Boulder, where I'm teaching presently, and Professor Gillian Porter is teaching as well. This event is made possible with the involvement of Jordan Center at NYU and also the Central Asian Faculty Network at the University of Colorado Boulder and the Department of Germanic and Slavic Languages and Literatures, also CU Boulder. And today it is my great pleasure to introduce Galina Babak. The publication of Galina's book entitled Atlantis of Soviet National Modernism, The Formal Method in Ukraine in the 1920s and the beginning of 1930s, that was published in 2021 by NLO, a volume that is co-authored by Galina and Alexander Dmitriev, became a real event and a revelation for our discipline. And I imagine it's familiar to a lot of participants here, but if it is not, I urge you all to rush and read it. It is a paradigm changing publication. And a few words about Galina. She has received her PhD in Slavic literatures at the Charles University in Prague. And her doctoral project is titled Reception of Russian Formalism in Ukrainian Culture in the Interwar Period. In 2020 and 21, she was a Pontica Magna Research Fellow at the New Euro College in Bucharest. In 2022, she was the Gerda Hankel Research Fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in Bulgaria. And presently, she is a research fellow at Free University in Berlin. And her work is primarily focused on the area of intellectual history, history of science, with the focus on literary theory and comparative literatures, mainly Ukrainian and Russian. So it is my pleasure to welcome Galina Babak. And before I give the word to her, I would encourage you to keep an eye for our future events. We still have a few series left in the semester. You can see the schedule on the Jordan Center website, but our next speaker will be Ася Баздарєва, and it will be terrific as well. So without further delay, I'm giving the word to Galina Babak. Welcome.
Thank you, Nastya. I hope to be terrific today at the previous and the next speakers. Thank you, University of Colorado Boulder, and thanks to New York Jordan Center. It's a pleasure to have a lecture today. First of all, I will share my screen with you. My today's topic is Soviet industrialization and Ukrainian literature of the 1920s and beginning of 1930s. As you can see, I took the collage created by modern contemporary Ukrainian poet Yakiva, Dream About Donetsk, because I will talk about Donetsk a lot today. In my today's lecture, I will talk about several areas and place names that, starting from the full-scale Russian invasion of Ukraine, became places of fierce battles, bombing, shelling, etc. And most of them were almost destroyed, as Bakhmut, Makiivka, Gorlivka, Mariinka, Mariupol, Azovstal, and unfortunately so on. So in a sense, it would be a traveling to the history of phantom places. As everyone here knows, the so-called construction of the Soviet society that started from the 1917 revolutions and civil war went through several stages. In various historical periods, the tools, context, and strategy of building communism were different, even though the general intention persisted. This can be applied to the industrialization of Soviet society, which in the cultural aspect will become the main topic today. First, I would like to discuss the relationship between Soviet industrialization and the so-called Cultural Revolution. Both, together with collectivization of the agriculture sector, were the part of the so-called Lenin's plan of building socialism. Industrialization meant the rapid growth of large-scale industry and the strengthening of the country's defense capability. So, along with the modernization of old factories, since 1927, the construction of more than 500 large objects of heavy industry, energy, and transport began. As part of this process, by 1928, the NEP, New Economic Policy, the most important element of the recovery period, was phased out. The beginning of socialist industrialization was laid by the first five-year plan for the development of national economy, which was adopted in October 1928, but officially approved only in May 1929. The five-year plans greatly accelerated industrial development, albeit at an enormous human cost of the peasantry. Soviet industrialization was unthinkable without cultural revolution. Literature played a crucial role in this plan. First of all, there was war on literacy, but no less important was the building of the production line of Soviet literature of a new society. The attempts to develop this sort of cultural literary industry were undertaken from the beginning of the 20th century. And here I mean constructivist, RAP, Proletkult. But also from the end of the 1920s, the beginning of the 1930s, literature in general became an effective tool of cultural revolution and therefore of promoting industrialization itself. It's worth mentioning that one of the important tools of the industrialization and cultural revolution were purges of Soviet intelligentsia, which was involved in these both two processes. And here I mean two very important trials. The first one is this Шахты one, Шахтинское дело. On the map, you may see the city of Шахты. Now it's Ростов region. It's marked in dark green. But till 1925, it was the part of Soviet Ukraine. 53 engineers from the coal industry and from the old generation, they were arrested after being accused of conspiring to sabotage the Soviet economy with the former owners of the coal mines. And the second one, very important process for the life of the Ukrainian intelligentsia, was the case of the Union for the Liberation of Ukraine. The abbreviation is SVU, Spilka Vyzvolenia Ukrainy, fabricated by the State Political Directorate of the Ukrainian SSR. It was reported that the SVU was an anti-Soviet organization that was created by representatives of the old intelligentsia, former supporters of the Ukrainian People's Republic, Simon Petlura, as well as figures from the Ukrainian Autocephalous Orthodox Church. And the trial was in Kharkiv in 1913. So the reverse side of the Cultural Revolution meant cleansing of the cultural field from ideologically hostile elements, including national ones. Denunciations and accusations of counter-revolutionary activities, bourgeois nationalism, sabotage, fellow traveling, etc., became important tools for carrying out such a policy. Ukraine was one of the main battlefields of industry. In Ukraine, this led to rapid economic, social, cultural, and political transformation. By the outbreak of the Second World War, industrial output had increased fourfold. The number of workers had tripled, and the urban population had grown from 19% to 34% of the total. Through with the sectoral bias toward heavy industry and the regional concentration in the Donetsk Basin, known as Donbas, and central Dnieper area, Ukraine had undergone a remarkable industrial development. Here, actually, you may see the two posters that promote mechanization of mines. The first one from Alexander Denek and the second one is Vasily Remilov's. Along with rapid industrialization, the process of industrial production of Soviet Ukrainian literature about industrialization was going on. The idea of building a new era was closely connected to the idea of a new individual and a new society. In his speech at the 17th Party Congress in 1929, Mykola Skripnik, at that time the People's Commissar of Education, who was originally from the city Yasinuvata near Bakhmut, said, "Our country is a gigantic and unprecedented factory, a laboratory for producing a new person. Here at new factories and plants at our enterprises, a new type of person is being formed, who works differently, builds his life and his attitude towards himself and the society differently. This new type of literature, of course, consisted of different literary genres, which underwent radical transformation in the process. Since the late 1920s, the so-called production novel, as well as the educational novel, gained its popularity. Along with this, in the early 1930s, on the initiative of Maxim Gorky, an ambitious project of the writing of the history of factories and plants was launched. Since the 1920s, and especially with the beginning of the large-scale industrialization, the so-called industrial tourism became popular, and the genres of reportage and travelogue were developing. In the field of poetry, preferences was given to industrial topics and the price of a new socialist technological reality. In Russian literature, it was Lev, which developed literature of fact, and simultaneously Ukrainian pan-futurist developed a theory of left reportage, for example, Alexa Polteratsky. And of course, there was a lot of writers and literary groups who were actively engaged in this process. Among the main literary organizations were who participated in the Cultural Revolution during the first five-year plans were, here I will name just the main one, but of course there were much more. I will just, you may read the list. I will just highlight the pan-futurists. At that time, they named themselves as All Ukrainian Association of Workers of Communist Culture. And in 1927-1930, they published journal Nova Generacija. Then there was avant-garde a group led by Valian Poryshuk, who named themselves as constructivists, but it was a little bit different constructivists for what in Russian literature we have. Komsomol writers group Molodnyak, all Ukrainian peasant writers union Plukh, and then Donbas group of proletarian writers Zaboy. And today I will talk a lot about this precise group because it's quite interesting phenomenon which not formed the contemporary Ukrainian literature canon of the 1920s. The meaning of the word is the face is the surface where the mining work is advancing. So I'm not sure if it's the right translation, but I hope so. Another one is All Ukrainian Association of Proletarian Writers, abbreviation is WUSP, which was an umbrella for different groups and publishings, and under this umbrella, such journals as Heart, Zoria, Stapeli, Metalevi Dni, Metal Days, Zaboy, and Red Bird in Kharkiv, they were published. In fact, a great number of writers and poets were engaged in the glorifying of the achievements of industrialization. For example, in 1929, a former pan-futurist Mykola Bajan published the triptych Edifices. He describes three architectural structures characteristic of three epochs: the Middle Ages, the Kazakh Hetmanate, and the Soviet era. The poem interprets national history, contrasting the past with modernity. In the third part of the poem, Building, the author depicts socialist reality as better and more progressive than previous historical epochs. Here I will ask you to read in English, and I will read the original text, I mean the excerpt, not the whole one. В'їдається у степ цупка робота та, як смерч, поставлений донизу головою, трясе рівниною і двигає горою, мов аркуші з шари землі горта, і вибуха, як постріл рух, розряд міцних натуг. Тут буяє труд, і прух ляга на прух, і кут ляга на кут, луна йде навкруг, споруд. Ідуть потужні голоси, як лави невгомовні, і відгукаються баси тяжкої електровні. And now I will discuss several major cases. And the main case will be Donbass. Donbass was always perceived as a special region with its heavy industry built in the end of the 19th century. An iron works was set up in 1872 by Welsh engineer John Hughes at the site of present-day Donetsk. So that's why it was first named as Yuzovka, then Stalin, and then Stalina till 1961. Donbass mixed population and its numerous working class made it different from the neighboring Russian and Ukrainian regions. Donbass was crucial for the industry of Russian Empire, of course, and of course it was supported to be even more important for the new Soviet state. In 1922, Lenin wrote, Donbass is not a random region. It's a region without which socialist construction will remain just a good expectation. And here you may see posters from the Civil War. The first one is of 1919, and the next two one is of 1921. And on the last poster you may see, it's written Donbass, Serce России. What actually gives a quite evident perspective. In the 1920s, Donbass became a dominant subject for the new type of literature, especially in the period of the first five-year plan. I will mention just several reasons for it. The first one, as I said, Donbass already had an industrial infrastructure by the 1920s, which was modernized during the following years. Secondly, I will point out revolutionary traditions here. And here I mean Donetsk Krivoy Rih, Donetsk Krivoy Rog Soviet Republic that was proclaimed on the 12th February 1918, and the chairman of the Council of People's Republic Council of People's Commissars was Russian revolutionary known as Artom, but his real name was Fadei Sergeyev. Its organizers intended in this way to exclude the government of the Central Rada from the industrial regions of the Donbass, even though it officially existed only for a month and was not appreciated by Lenin, it was largely supported by the local revolutionary authorities. And here you may see two monuments to Artom. The first one was destroyed during the German occupation, but later I will talk more, or not me, but in quotation we will find the description of this monument. And the next one is still, I hope, there. This city now is Svyatohirsk. Before it was Slavyanohirsk. It's near monastery. It was quite heavy shelled during last half a year. And both of them, they were designed by sculptor Ivan Kavaleridze. Thirdly, it was always culturally, Donbass was always culturally and linguistically diverse region where Russian language was mixed with Ukrainian. That is why this new sort of literature was written in both languages. That is how Mykola Skripnik characterized the language use situation in the light of the policy of Ukrainization in the late 1920s. I will read the quote in the original. Колись багато товаришів гадали, що Донбас – це не Україна, а робітники Донбасу здебільше не українці. Виявляється тепер, що це цілком невірно. Серед гірняків три чверті, тобто близько 70% робітників – українців. Значить, кількість донбаських робітників говорить ломаною мовою. Мовою українською, але з домішками російських слів, з перекрученням мови взагалі, так що вони правильно не говорять ні українською, ні російською. Українська книжка, бібліотеки, український театр, українська газета допоможуть донбасівцям оволодіти українською мовою і придбати собі знання української культури. This could be fully illustrated by the history of literary, artistic, social and political monthly magazine «Забой», published in 1923-1935, in Artyomivsk, what is now contemporary Bakhmut, by the Union of Donbas Proletarian Writers of that same name. Its founders and first editors were Yevgeny Schwartz and Mikhail Slonimsky, who in 1922 came from Petrograd to Bakhmut to visit Schwartz's father. At that time, he worked as a doctor at the salt mine. First, the magazine was published as a literary supplement to the newspaper All Russian Kochegarka and later as a separate edition. In 1923-1927, it was published only in Russian. Starting from 1928, it included materials both in Ukrainian and Russian languages and circulated in 32,000 copies monthly. In 1931-1933, it changed its title into Literaturny Donbas and was published in Ukrainian. Its main editors at the time were Ukrainian writers Grigory Barlyuk and Vasil Gaivarovsky. In 1933, they were persecuted, but magazine continued to exist in Russian language till 1935. And it, of course, it was renamed, and now it was Literaturny Donbas. Here you may see the example from 1934. His main editor during the last years was the poet Pavel Bespashadny, who was known as Donbas Burns. Actually, it's very famous poet of Donbas. Zaboy claimed to be the only true literary representative of Donbas proletariat. Along with the professional writers, its main contributors were ordinary workers from coal mines and iron factories. The magazine published stories, novels, poems, and reportages that depicted everyday life of industrial Donbas. Here you may see production problems at plants, factories and mines, etc. It became a kind of chronicle of the time. Among its authors in different times were Boris Gorbatov, Ivan Lee, Ivan Mikitenko, Felix Kovalevsky, Alexander Donbasky, Isaac Babil, Volodymyr Sasura, Nikolai Olenikov, Demian Bedny, Eduard Bagritsky, Sergei Yesenin, Pavel Bespashadny, Yuri Cherkasky, Matvey Matusovsky, Yaroslav Smelyakov, Alexander Farber. Among literary critics, there were highly engaged Russian critic Alexei Selivanovsky and Ivan, Ukrainian critic Ivan Tkachenko. The image of Donbas with its mines constantly appeared in poems of Volodymyr Sasura, who was originally from Donetsk region. For example, here is an excerpt from the poem Miner, which tells the story of a miner, Vanya, who made a career from the worker to the clerk of the miners' committee, so-called Shachtkom. I'm sorry for the translation. I'm not a translator. Yeah, so I will quote it in the original text and you may understand what it's said from English. У шаткомі роботи багато, але Ваня сміється й тепер. Хоч і важче, ніж кайлом довбати, підписати невеличкий папер. Тільки серце про щось заговорить і тривогу заб'є з глибини, коли мимо проходять шахтери і зникають у кліті вони. Another interesting and important case is... Oh, I forgot to put it here, okay, I'm sorry, is women poetry that was not much represented and actually almost was not represented in the journal. There were some articles about the so-called women's question or women's production and so on, or women's in art, the way we should depict women or the way women should be appeared in different literary and artistic works. And I wanted to quote the poem by Daria Drushkova, "Мої руки пахнуть бензином," but unfortunately I forgot to... I forgot to put it in my presentation, so maybe I will come back to it. From the end of the 1920s century, there was taken a course on the mass production of literature that celebrates the achievements of industrialization. There were writers groups opened at almost every factory where professional authors taught young workers how to write. For example, Vladimir Belyaev published a note on the need to educate a new generation of writers in the journal Nova Generacija in 1929. He stated, "The industrial center of Ukraine, Donbas, should give Ukrainian literature proletarian writers of a new type, poets of heavy industry and socialist construction, who will replace the modern Vertinskys from literature." And here you may see, as an example, the WUSPs, the All Ukrainian Union of Proletarian Writers, order from 1930, published in Metalevi Dni, Metal Days. Yeah. So they called to send its members to the Kharkiv factories to organize the process of the institutionalized literary production. And here, of course, it's in Ukrainian, but it's written «З постанови поширеного секретаріату ВУЗП у членів Харківської організації прикріплено для постійної роботи на харківських заводах». So, and the list of the different literati who had to provide this work in different Kharkiv factories. In particular, there was a mass production of the so-called production novel with elements of Bildungsroman. In its focus appeared to be heroic work and the process of production itself. In a sense, ethics, aesthetics, ideology of labor became a mechanism that contributed to the formation of the self-awareness of the region. One of the first examples of this genre in Soviet literature was Gladkov's Cement from 1925. And here I wouldn't comment too much on it, as Katerina Clark and Evgeny Dobrynka wrote a lot about its ritualized form. I will give you an example of formation of the ideologically consistent genre of production novel. In this sense, I will refer to Ivan Tkachenko's 1933 review of two novels by Ukrainian writer Dmytro Gardienko. The first one is Tinda from 1930, and you can see the cover of it. The second one is Zavoyovnik i Nadry, Conquerors of the Subsoil. Unfortunately, I didn't find the cover. Both of them correspond with the so-called Shakhty trial, about which I talked at the beginning. Tinda's fabula is typical for detective story. Colonel Tinda, the son of landowner, a former fighter in the Denikin and Petlura armies, is a work manager of a mine. With the help of some foreign industrialists and former owner of coal mines, Tinda tries to inflict harm to the coal mining. There are also a love story. In the end, Tinda was exposed by Komsomolka Maria Morozovna and shot by a worker. In Gordienko's next novel, a miners' collective conducts a hard class struggle and pushes the reconstruction of the old mine in accordance with the requirements of the latest advanced technology. In his review, Tkachenko criticized Tindra for its belonging to adventure literature and for a lack of psychologism in depiction of main characters. But at the same time, he criticizes Conquerors of the Subsoil for its plain plot and states, "Tinda is undoubtedly an anti-artistic work, but it's readable because of its adventurous plot. In the new work, the author avoided adventurousness, but this came at the cost of reducing its readability." The novel appears by the another one very famous author who formed later the canon of Soviet literature, Luhansk writer Boris Gorbatov, who actually famous for his novel Donbass, written later after the Second World War. But today I will talk about his novel Ravesnik Appears, which appeared in Ukrainian. What was not typical for this author, because he is a Russian language author, and this is what was the time when literary Donbass started to be published in Ukrainian. It appeared in several parks in 1933. As I know, it was never released a separate edition and was never included into his further collections. The novel is interesting as an example of Bildungsroman. It opposes the stories of two friends, Alyosha and Pavlik. Alyosha, after graduating from school in Mariupol, travels to the Donbas to understand what he wants to do in his life. On the way to Volnovakha, he decides to visit his friend Pavlik, who works at an iron plant near Kharkiv. After meeting with Pavlik, and most importantly, after watching him at work, a metamorphosis occurs with Alyosha. Here you have quotes that actually is like the ending of this novel. Yeah, I will quote it in original, and please read it in English. І Альоша не знав, чи пожаліти Павлика, що не побачить він ні Маріуполя, ні синь моря, ні далеких країв, чи позазрити йому. Павлик ішов заводом, мов хазяїн, він усе знав тут. Він усе розказав хлопцям, він розбирався в заводському хаосі, мов у себе в кишені. І хлопці побачили, як входить завод мертва тьмяна руда з домішкою глини і перетворюється на чавун, як чавун перетворюється на сталь, сталь на болванку, болванка на рейку. Сива, виблискуючи сталлю, рейка ляже на землю. По ній, Федор Ковбиш, ти можеш приїхати до моря? Ось що таке завод. Ні, коли вже працювати на заводі, так треба охопити все. Альоша не піде на Волноваху. Він не піде з Ковбишем до моря. Він і тут не залишиться. Він повернеться до міста, він вчитиметься далі, він багато вчитиметься. Він навчиться і приїде сюди. Йому все стане зрозуміле, те, чого не розуміє навіть Павлик. Як багато може зробити людина? Людина збудувала цей завод, людина гарматними зруйнувала його, людина, голодуючи, голими руками відновила його. Людина, люди можуть все. Альоша стане такою людиною, великою людиною стане, людиною великих знань і великої волі.
We'll continue with the next genre. As I mentioned above, in the 1920s, industrial tourism was quite popular, especially among writers. And the first one who began to publish their reports on Donbas, it was Pan Futurists. They published on Donbas, Dniprostan, Kharkiv factories. For example, the sixth issue of The New Generation for 1929 was half devoted to the Donbas. Below, here I translated some of the excerpts from the, as authors identified it, Combined Literary and Photo Reportage by Alexa Polteratsky and Dan Sotnik. This is the way how it was published. This is actually the quote from them. Donbas is on halfway.
Артемівське, колишній Бахмут. Невеличке місто, в якому ніякого руху не відчувається. Не відчувається центру. І тільки грандіозний Артем нагадує, що навколишні шахти й заводи. Артем на пам'ятнику здійняв кулака високо вгору, і це є ніби символ округового центру, що в руках своїх затиснув кілька великих комбінатів. Горлівка – колишня дірка в степу, дірка в оточенні церквів, кабаків, борделів, нині величезна рудоуправа і виробниче управління підземними рудами і вугіллям, нині палац культури. Макіївка – в оточенні установ з ентомологічним назвиськом Макропкоп та вивісок Дмитрівський район, комітет МОПР та районна рада ООО «Авіахим», Макіївка двох заводів, що з них кожний велике місто. Сталіне, колишня станція Юзовка, селище з невеличких хатинок, тепер місто шкляно-бетонових будинків, місто, де мешканці ходять в усю широчінь вулиць, бо на панелі не проштовхнутись. Ходять по звичці так навіть тоді, коли на вулиці порожня. Артемівське, Горлівка, Макіївка, Сталіне – це чотири опірні пункти Донбасу, де були ми. І цей шматок Донбасу править мені за пробу всього Донбасу. Я приїхав у Артемівське. Міщанський центр, типова провінція, попереджали мене. Неправда. у сучасних умовах провінції взагалі не існує. Я радився з цього приводу з багатьма товаришами-футуристами. Так, її немає. В міщанському центрі я побачив прекрасні книжкові крамниці з найостаннішими книжковими новинами, арсенал Довженка у кіно, а під той час у Харкові його ще не демонстрували. Ввечері я міг милуватися радіо, що передавало п'яту симфонію Бетховена у виконанні оркестри артемівських пожежників. А далі я розпомів за шахту і цим виправдав свої слова. Єдиний порятунок шахтаря у механізації шахт. П'ятирічка передбачає механізацію 75%, і тоді шахтар стане культурним наглядачем упокірливої машини. Шахтар завжди романтик. 6 годин рабської праці примушують його дивитися з надр землі на її поверхню, як правовірного християнина з землі на небо. Металіст же, як культурна людина, бажає мати й культурну розвагу. Це добре врахували капіталістичні власники копалень, коли брали шахти і завод у коло церквів, кабаків і борделів. And here probably I will stop. I will just say that this is a huge material that is impossible to cover within one lecture, and unfortunately we don't have time to talk about literature about Dniprostan or Kharkiv factories and plants. There were a lot of genres around Dniprostan and its building, and for example there were so-called, I named it as production folklore, for example, different частушки, rhymed small poems, yeah. Some of the closing remarks. All this material, which is practically not introduced into scientific circulation, requires careful study. First of all, this material is important from the perspective of how the universal project of industrialization and cultural revolution was implemented within the framework of the Ukrainian SSR, taking into account bilingualism, social stratification, the characteristics of the region, and etc. Pure literary studies cannot provide enough framework for such research. The focus of the future work should be shifted to the history of the most important aspects, like national, imperial, colonial, and the study of various types of modernities. Secondly, from the historical perspective, this material could be considered as the richest source which could provide understanding of the cultural crucial change of the Soviet internal politics from Kreninizatsiya to the different Stalinist type of policy. And the last one, that is important to know that we are talking about the resource industry here. That means that on the example of Donbas, one can trace the role of the natural, of how natural resources played in the formation of the Soviet economy, in particular Soviet Ukrainian economy and Soviet political regime in the late 1920s and the late 1930s. Here I meant some of the existing works on this topic. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope everything is okay this time because I was worried about it a lot. So probably I will stop sharing, yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for this extremely rich and so wonderfully researched presentation, Galina. And now it's time for questions. So our audience members, feel free to either raise your hand or put a question in the chat and I will moderate it. And while you're making up your minds, I guess I will start with the first question. So Galina, if you could maybe spend some more time on maybe addressing some of the very provocative and synthetic questions that you put on the final slide, right? Maybe could you tell us some more, or give us more examples about kind of some of the patterns or maybe some antinomies for shaping of this kind of synthetic figure of a new Soviet Ukrainian industrial person who is at the same time is Ukrainianophone, right? What were some of the contradictions? What were some of the solutions to the contradictions that the authors that you addressed provided? So maybe we can start with that.
Thank you for the core question, Nesta. I will start. There are two aspects, yeah, very important. The first one is the situation dramatically changed
in actually 1 year, 1928, 1929, and this journal Zaboy could illustrate it. Yeah, the changing of the languages and the changing of the language policy. Yeah. As for this so-called national element, yeah, and how this national situation influenced or national question, yeah, it also was subordinated to this like internal policy. As for examples, for example, there is a reportage of pan futurist Georg Korupi, who traveled to Dniprostan in 1928. Actually, the building of Dniprostan began already in 1927. And the thing was that to build Dniprostan or Dniprohes, yeah, known as Dniprohes, they need to water parogi, how you call it, of the river. So Dnipro was very famous by its
rapid.
How?
River rapids.
Yeah. So they needed to water it. Yeah. And so there were a lot of tourists, I mean, not only literary tourists, yeah, who came there. I mean, geologists, for example, Javornitsky, he wrote a book about the Dnipro Porogi. It was published, like republished recently. And in this reportage, for example, there is a funny sketch on the language situation, because like they talked to the workers in Ukrainian, and the workers say, no, we don't understand Ukrainian, we are Russians, we speak Russian, and we are probably Russians. And then Georg Krupi started to talk with them and say, okay, so if you're Russian, so probably you don't like Ukrainian, like something. And he actually gives the exam. They said, no, we like this, and we like this. And actually, in the end, they say, oh, okay, so we are Ukrainians. So this, I would say, like a kind of very not stable identity, yeah, and the way it is depicted, yeah. So it's one of the ways it could be depicted, yeah. And we can understand, like, in the from these literary examples, that the situation was like that. Another one, of course, it's in this journal Zaboy Literaturny Donbas and so on. There are several. Actually, a lot of issues from 1928, 1929, and even 1930, which published like both Ukrainian and in Ukrainian and Russian, they published both writers who published in Ukrainian language, but originally they wrote poems in Russian. So we don't know whether they translated themselves in Ukrainian into Ukrainian, or they were translated by somebody. Yeah, so this is a kind of example of this national aspect. I mean, but just would like to highlight once again that I would not in the sense of this national policy, I would not take Donbas as an exemplary because of a lot of reasons, and first of all because of the traditions of this working class struggle, yeah, for its rights. So it's a kind of like another story that couldn't be explicit to the whole part of Ukraine. Yeah, I'm sorry if I don't answer, I don't know if I answered your question. But...
No, thank you so much. Julian, you have... Please.
Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation. Something I'm interested in is the question of how different sources of energy might produce distinctive aesthetics in literature and film. So a number of the materials you were discussing were poems, and in some cases some novels about Donbass, and in many cases about coal mining, in some cases even written by coal miners, it sounds like. And I'm just wondering, based on the texts you have personally reviewed, if you might be able to suggest any specific features of coal literature about Donbass. Are there particular poetic forms that you commonly meet in in this literature about coal mining specifically, or, you know, is there any literary tradition that these writers are drawing on in terms of representing coal that maybe predates the Soviet period? Or just, I mean, when you look at this literature that's about coal, is there anything there that seems specific that's not, that couldn't be equally said about the other literary works that are about industrialization more broadly in this period? And also, is there a coal, if there is a coal novel, right, is there the coal novel about coal mining in Donbass that we should be reading if we want to be reading important literary engagements with coal? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your very interesting questions. As for the first question, I would say that language is different, yeah, and terms, they are different. For example, when I quoted you from Sasura's poem, it probably, even in English, it would be hard to understand what he is meaning. I mean, this klet, this precisely, I mean, cell, when they have to go in to go down, yeah. So for this specific naming, there are a lot of for the specific phenomenon, there are a lot of different naming that you can't read it not going to the vocabulary. And if actually before I didn't know what is zaboy, for example, it wasn't a word that I used. Yeah, so language, of course, dictates everything. As for the form, it's an interesting question, because I read in 1925-1926 zaboy made a kind of questionnaire of the contributors to the journal, and the questionnaire was like, what is your favorite authors and whom you read? And the answers were like, most of them, they answered Sergei Yesenin. And actually, and I just want to highlight that it was published by non-professional writers. Of course, they also tried to engage professional writers from both Russian language and Ukrainian language literature within Soviet Ukraine, yeah. And of course, you've heard that Eduard Bagritsky and Olejnik and so on, they were taking part in it, yeah. But I mean, the like 90% of the content, it was just workers who felt this inspiration to write, and they decided to write. And I don't know if you ever wrote poems, but when you decide to be a kind of poet, you just it's really hard to start, yeah, and you just try to imitate something that you already knew or read or something like this, yeah. And if you just read these poems, you will for sure like find or trace the origins of Yesenin and so on, yeah, or Sasura, for example, Vladimir Sasura. So I can't say that there was something, a kind specificity of the form in the sense of coal mining literature. I don't see, maybe, I don't know, further research will show us. As for the second question, what is like the novel, actually, I don't know, because I haven't read a lot or all of them. It's from what I read, I would, but it's a little bit later, yeah. I would recommend this Kharbatov Donbass. It's like a kind of classical one, yeah. But it's written in Russian, and I don't know how, that's a question actually, if it's a part of like Ukrainian literature or Russian literature, it's a part of actually Soviet canon, or literary canon. And actually, except for like Donbass region, it's almost forgotten author, but it was quite famous and so on and so forth. Yeah. And I'm sure there are a lot of other interesting novels, because it's like huge amount. I even didn't imagine how many it was written, yeah. And a lot of authors that actually are not the part of contemporary canon, or maybe some of of their, like, for example, Микола Хвильовий. Микола Хвильовий, in 1922, he published Юрко, it's the personal name, yeah, about the situation of the, like, in the first year, post-revolutionary year in Donbass, and his main hero is also, like, coal miner. And later, actually, he came back to this topic and published several stories in 1932, 1933, a kind of like a very ideologized and aesthetically very poor, I would say so. And but if we are talking about like canon of contemporary Ukrainian literature, we will talk about Микола Хвильовий pamphlets, his I'm Romanticism, Я Романтика, and a lot of other stuff, Санитарина Зона, and so on. Yeah, but we will never talk about this latest, for example, novels. Yeah, no, except maybe several researchers. Yeah, so it's also like a kind of tricky question, like, you know, you ask the core question, actually, what is the mechanism of the canon formation? So I don't know which to choose.
I have a follow-up question, which I'll allow myself to ask because there are no questions yet, but audience, I do encourage you to please put them in the chat to raise your hand. So the follow-up question is this. So Galina, what is your sense? Could you tell us whether any of the Donbass industrial novels, especially the ones written in Ukrainian, are read in Ukraine now? And if not, what are some of the obstacles for their entry into the canon, right? Maybe productive obstacles or productive paradoxes that are interesting to consider. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, that's actually the question I was thinking, like while preparing just this presentation. So I don't know. So I know, as I can check the textbooks on contemporary Ukrainian literature, what they taught at schools. But actually, I graduated from school, 15 years, 20 years ago, 18 years ago. I don't remember. Yeah. So that's quite long ago. And what should I say? I never heard about a specific genre of production novel when I was in literature, and actually at the university also it was not taught. I never heard about the zaboy, for example, or this part of like literary groups and so on. Yeah. I have never read any kind, except like, you know, from Ivan Frankos, who is like one of Ukrainian classic, but he didn't write about Donbass. He wrote about like Burislav Smietse, about the Galicia and the coal mining in Burislav. So that was an example, for example. Yeah. But if we're talking about like, for example, they are also not included in the canon. About pre-revolutionary literature, we will name Boris Grinchenko, for example, yeah, or Spiridon Cherkasin, because he also writes a lot about the status of mine workers and so on, about their hard work. So hard work is a kind of like very important concept before industrialization, yeah, because like it was like a measure, and after industrialization, it's like hard but very important, happy work, because we are working for the better socialist future. So it's a kind of changing of the concept. Yeah. And just to be very short, no, I have never I have never touched upon this during my school and university years. Yeah. As for how this topic is popular, it's not a popular topic. Unfortunately, in contemporary Ukrainian literary studies, we don't have a kind of ours Yevgeny Dobrenko. So we need just to have Yevgeny Dobrenko, who will just read all the production novels and write about the Farmovka of Soviet Ukrainian writer, and then we'll have a kind of Bible we can use in this sense. There are several, it's also an interesting aspect, because there are several scholars who study Soviet socialist canon, because it's like we are talking about socialist canon, you know. And they took totally different examples. The most prominent example of socialist realism in Ukraine is Gonchar Sabor, Cathedral Gonchars, yeah. Okornichuk, for example, his dramas, yeah. But nobody talks about production novel, or nobody like, you know, so, or for example, works on the history of factories. So it's just a topic that that needs to, that waits for its researcher, I would say so.
Thank you so much. This is so fascinating and important. Any questions from the audience? Right, the audience is silent. I have another follow-up question. So did Dobrienko, Katerina Clark, in their kind of magisterial reviews of industrial literature, include Ukrainian novels in that? I mean, given that Donbas is the site of industrialization.
As I know, no.
Yeah.
No. It's interesting also that we were talking about socialist realist canon. It's enough to talk just about like Russian literature. But if you're talking about Ukrainian or any, I suppose, any other national literature, it's never enough to talk only about like Ukrainian one. You always have to choose a comparative aspect, yeah, for like quite understandable reasons. As I know, I've just checked Katerina Clark book. No, she talks about Gorky, about Gladkov, but she doesn't give an example of, yeah, but maybe in some other works, so I didn't notice it.
Yeah, thank you. Jillian.
Thank you. I'll permit myself a follow-up to that. I was actually wondering along the lines of that question, whether you would venture to say that focusing in on literature of industrialization in Ukraine in the 1920s and 30s gives us a new understanding of literature of industrialization in the Soviet Union. I mean, in other words, when, you know, through your research, when you focus on Ukraine, I mean, how do we understand, you know, this project, this moment differently than if we're not focusing on Ukraine?
Yeah, it's an important question. Thanks. I was also thinking about it, like what it gives to us. In my opinion, just to understand, so Soviet Union, the Soviet Union, it is the, because it was formed of different nationalities and national republics, even though they were like not so autonomous federative, yes. Not could be, but like expected to be. I think in to understand like this whole structure with all the nuances, it's really important to study national context, not only Ukrainian one. For example, we don't know much about because of language also. Yeah, but about like what was going on. Belarus, we can. I hope we can phrase away, we read something because it's quite in this area, yeah. But Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, and other countries. So I have any kind of imagination actually what the process was going on there and what was the policy of Soviet government over these national republics. And just providing this like a full scale picture, in my opinion, we can understand better like the inner mechanisms. And as your question probably was about literature, if it will give us like the better understanding of what was socialist realism canon, in a sense, yes, because I think in national republics there were different nuances because of this national, and maybe they survived the same processes but in different way and in different stages. Yeah, for example, it's quite strange that, for example, in this review 1933, Tkachenko criticized Gordienko for adventurous plot, for adventure, yeah, because Lydia Ginsburg wrote her novel, yeah, Pinkerton, later, and it was okay. And actually, we can understand also why Gordienko decided to write an adventurous novel because of the Bukharin's call to provide red Pinkertons, yeah. So, and it was thought that it was still okay when he wrote this poem in 1930, but indeed in a year it was already, but it started a little bit earlier. I mean, the critique of this precise aspect a little bit earlier than in Russian literature. So, for example, this is one of the aspects that we can think about it. And there are a lot of more. Yeah.
Thank you so much. You were once again introducing yet another Ukrainian Atlantis of material. So I'd like to thank Galina and Jillian and our wonderful audience who remain silent but supportive, and also our administrators, Alexander Spitalnik and Hilary Gerber. So thank you all so much for your participation and time, and we'll see you at the next installment of the Jordan Center series.
Thank you very much for all coming and for your wonderful questions. Thanks a lot.